Congressman Ron Paul joins us for the next 30 minutes. We really appreciate him joining us in his busy schedule. We're going to talk about the economy, the situation with Iran. Of course, what he talked about a decade ago is now unfolding, the financial collapse. Congressman Ron Paul, thank you for joining us today.
Good to be with you. Thank you.
So much is happening, but I saw a report yesterday put out by CNBC, also Zero Hedge, that the Federal Reserve is now the second largest holder of U.S. Treasury bonds. They own $821.1 billion. So not just the communist Chinese are basically controlling this country, but now the private Federal Reserve.
Yeah, and obviously they had to do that or interest rates would have popped up. But, you know, in some ways, if you're looking for some benefits from that, just think when we have true reform, there's no reason for the Treasury to pay these bills to the Fed. In an effort to go through a transition, it'd be nice if we could honor, you know, the Treasury bills held by private individuals who, you know, naively bought our government debt. But we do not have to pay that when we have our reform. We just throw that out because they're holding the debt. And if we had a new system, it wouldn't be necessary.
There was a headline in Market Watch of the Wall Street Journal yesterday with one of their analysts saying that they believe it'll be the end of the Federal Reserve by 2012. More and more, even mainstream media is sounding like Congressman Ron Paul.
Yeah, I'm amazed at the progress we've made with stations like yours and many others and on the Internet who have joined us. I'm sure you can remember 3 years ago, this was a non-event, you know, to talk about the Fed. We were still considered, you know, way outside kooks to even bring the subject up. But it is frequently discussed on the business channels, at least, not the political channels as much as the business channels. They're starting to realize that, you know, the Fed is responsible. So I keep harping at it that if you want full employment, that's why I always keep the door open for the left, because they always preach we care about the poor and we care about jobs. What they do, they have to look at monetary policy and just look how this system destroys the middle class. The first people to lose their jobs are the people who were supposed to be helped by the Barney Franks of the world. And here they end up losing their houses, losing their jobs. And who gets bailed out? You know, the big mortgage companies, the big gamblers, the ones who made billions of dollars when the bubble was being inflated, and now they're still making money. But I think the people are waking up. I think they're much aware of what's happening. The Fed is not going to get off the hook. No matter what they do, they cannot escape the blame.
Well, we've got this outside branch of government that's private that you've tried to audit. And now they've positioned us to where they're the second biggest owner of our debt, along with communist China. I don't know which one is worse. I mean, we're clearly being conquered economically through this fraud. But because it is a fraud, if we just stand up and say no to it, as you said, we have no responsibility to pay this money.
Yeah, and the time will come. I mean, the default is on its way. And Bernanke actually is very sympathetic to inflation. And he also understands that printing money causes price inflation. And when you have the price inflation devaluing the currency, this literally reduces real debt. So if he can double prices and double it with doubling the money supply, you know, the debt goes down by 50%.
Gosh.
He's just disappointed that the prices aren't going up fast enough, so the devaluation is bad, it's horrible, but he even wants more of it.
Amazing. Stay there, Congressman. When we come back, I want you as an economic expert in this area and who have obviously been part of the testimony and hearing so many times researching this to break down what devaluation of the currency means. The Federal Reserve was on the news yesterday. Saying, yes, we want inflation to fix the debt. So explain to people what that means and solutions out of this crisis on the other side with Dr. Ron Paul. Back in 1999, when they got rid of the Glass-Steagall Act and allowed the private megabanks to start issuing even more counterfeit financial instruments, Ron Paul said, this will cause this country to collapse. This will overextend the empire. And I remember him even putting the number on it, you know, that he would say clearly in the next 10 to 15 years. Well, here we are 11 years later, and it's not prophecy. It's just good economics, strong free market understanding of what's happening. And the congressman joins us in the short segment. We were getting into the situation of the private Federal Reserve being the second biggest holder of U.S. Treasuries. over $821 billion, close second to communist China. And the congressman has been talking about the collapse that we're going into, and we have all the economic numbers there. We never left the recession, and by most yardsticks, we're in a depression. So can you give us a forecast from your deep research and the word you're getting up there on the banking committee about where we are, Congressman Ron Paul, and the Fed's signals to accelerate the monetization of debt, clearly driving the dollar down and gold up?
Right, and although we can be optimistic about what's changing in the country, a lot of attitudes are improving. There's a better understanding of free market economics and Austrian economics and the importance of gold and how significant the Fed is. In Washington, no attitudes have changed. Bernanke and others, Geithner, these guys will just, they have their wall, their back up against the wall. So instead of saying, hey, maybe I was wrong, which they're incapable psychologically to do, because that means they've invested 30 or 40 years in promoting this nonsense, they can't admit that. So the worse things get, the more they continue to do bad policy, and that is spend, borrow, inflate, and regulate. They think regulations can compensate for the market regulating, and therefore they can make, you know, they can do this economic planning through monetary policy. So nothing has changed there. So what that does, it guarantees the prolongation of the problems that we have. You have to have the liquidation of debt, and they will not permit the liquidation of debt. They just transfer the debt from their privileged friends over onto the taxpayers. So if you look at all the mortgage debt and the derivatives, that's what we bought. It's horrible that they have 800 and some billion dollars of treasury bills, but they have over $1 trillion of all this other bad debt, which is probably worthless. Should have been sold on the market for what the market would pay for it, but they bought it for these banks at the nominal rate. It's criminal, and it's just going to lead us to runaway inflation. All debts by government, when it gets out of hand, the debt gets liquidated. It doesn't get liquidated by them for refusing to pay the debt. It's liquidated by passing out money that's cheap, and that's what devaluation is all about. They're devaluing the currency on purpose, sticking it to the person who might want to save or who has to live, you know, close on the margin. They get the higher prices. They lose their jobs. They lose their savings. And Austrian economics, and Mises pointed this out, that when you destroy a currency, you destroy the middle class. And that's what we're witnessing right now.
That's right. All the economic indicators are that the middle class is evaporating before our eyes. Here's the Wall Street Journal yesterday. Fed officials mull inflation as a fix. So they've always denied that they were using inflation to basically cover up the massive debts. Now they've gotten so desperate they're shifting gears. And Bernanke's saying, okay, we are in deep trouble. We are in a crisis. But I've got the solution. We're going to further devalue the dollar, but the answer is, according to his statements in the G20 statement, is this coordinated lowering of currencies, but they claim that that would stop any type of currency war, but as you know, Congressman, the currency war is now on, and so just as we saw Weimar Republic Germany or Zimbabwe in the last few years in, of course, Africa, or a decade ago in Argentina, this unfolds the same way every time. Once you get to a tipping point, a flash point, the devaluation accelerates. You've talked about something big and bad cometh this way. Are we nearing a flash implosion point, or will it just be a continual devaluation?
Well, there eventually will be a crash of the dollar. But the whole policy makes no sense, just like we got into trouble by spending and borrowing and inflating, so we do more of it. But the whole idea that it's good for the people to depreciate their money, devalue the money, that means if you have $100 in the bank, tomorrow or the next week it's maybe worth 95 or 90. It's a criminal theft is what it is. But that's what they call good policy. And all the countries of the world are doing this, and it does go down gradually, and it doesn't go down, you know, you can't calculate it. If the Fed increases the money by 10% every year, that doesn't mean prices go up 10%, you know, every year. What happens is, you know, there's productivity that keeps prices down. There's the psychological factor. There's trust in the dollar. There's trust in the politicians. So you might have a steady erosion of the key currency, which is the dollar, which has happened. Since Bretton Woods, it's down about 35% against all other currencies. So it's hard to measure the destruction of the dollar just against currencies because all the other currencies are not much better. The only true test over the centuries has been the devaluation against gold. Gold measures value better than anything else. And who wants the value of their gold to go down in the purchasing power? It's always going up with the fiat money. But here we are, have the world competing to find out how fast they can devalue their currencies. It's absolutely insane, and it's very destructive. And the final stages, indeed, are rapid. Even though they're erratic as they inflate, there's finally a point in monetary destruction where everybody throws in the towel. Then they rush out of it, and everybody's working hard to prevent the panic. And they'll even interfere and get into markets to fudge the price of gold to prevent the panic. But when the time comes, you know, if it looks like it's going to zero or lose a lot, you know, the Chinese will dump it, everybody else will dump it, interest rates are going to go up, inflation rates are going to go up, the economy is going to get weaker, and then we as a country will be forced to have monetary reform, and we can't, and the only way you can have true monetary reform is you have to change the role of government. We cannot continue to be the policemen of the world and run a welfare state and think that changing the monetary system will help, because it won't. It'll just cause more confusion. So you have to revamp the whole idea about what our government should be doing, what the role of government is. The proper role of government under the law is very limited according to our Constitution. And the monetary issue has been well defined in the Constitution. So the answers are there, and one of these days soon, it could be in a year, it could be in 3 or 4 or 5 years, but it will come, but the gradual erosion of the purchasing power of the dollar will continue.
Congressman, looking at the death of the Anglo-American Empire, the British Empire, of course, after World War II kind of folded into the Anglo-American system, as Dr. Carl Quigley and others have written. So looking at this geopolitically and economically, you know, and as a doctor with the analogy, I mean, are we a year, 2 years, 3 years from the implosion of the empire? And then what comes out of that implosion of the empire? I mean, where is the United States going from here?
Well, there's no way anybody knows the precise time. But you can be certain that if certain events are occurring, like the depreciation of money and the continued inflating of the currency, it will come. But I'm sure we're getting much closer, and it could be within a few years. Now, when this happens, you can have two things. The status quo will not be maintained because all wealth is being shifted right now, like we said. It's being shifted away from the middle class and the wealthy, and the Wall Streeters and the bankers have all the wealth, and they'll probably have a lot of the gold as well. So we either shift toward going back to our roots and deciding the founders were on the right track, and we reinstate those views, or we do something like what happened to Germany in the 20s. It ushered in a militant, evil dictator, which was Hitler, who scapegoated a group of people that he blamed everything on the Jews, and the hatred was built. And today we have our scapegoats around, you know, let's hate this group, let's hate that group, blame them for the whole problem. So people are ripe for that. But in spite of that great danger, I still think we're making progress. I think we're really competing very well with those who are demanding a dictator. I haven't heard many people at our Tea Party groups, meetings that are demanding, things are so tough, what we need now is a dictator. What they want is less government and more power returned to the people.
That's right. We've gone through those cycles in the 20th century over and over again, people wanting the big strong man on the white horse, that Napoleonic or Hitlerian figure to save them. Worldwide, people know government is the conduit through which mega corporations loot and rob the people.